ओम सत गुरुभ्यो नमः। नमस्कारम टू वन एंड ऑल। वी आर वेरी हैप्पी टू हैव ऑल ऑफ यू गैदर्ड हियर फॉर द यंग रिसर्चर्स फोरम ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय ज्योतिर्दिया द एकेडमी ऑफ परफॉर्मिंग आर्ट्स मुंबई एंड द सेंटर फॉर एक्सलेंस आर्ट एंड कल्चर शासुन जैन कॉलेज चेन्नई। आई एम ऐश्वर्या हरीश, द कल्चरल कोऑर्डिनेटर फॉर ज्योतिर्दिया द एकेडमी ऑफ परफॉर्मिंग आर्ट्स मुंबई। After the successful inauguration of our first session by our Paramaguru Dr. Padma Subramaniam and Sri Shekhar Senji, we bring to you our second session. We begin the session with an auspicious prayer. This prayer is in praise of Madurai Meenakshi Devi, Devi Niyai Thunai, rendered by Akshaya Ramanathan, faculty, Center for Excellence, Art and Culture, Shasun Jain College.
Namaskaram, pranam to all my gurus.
Devi niye tune gambadi, Devi niye tune मधुरई वाल मीनलोचनी देवी नीगे तुड़ी तेन मधुरई वाल मीनलोचनी देवी।
Thank you, Akshaya, for that soulful rendering. I now would like to call upon Dr. Jayashree Rajagopalan, Director, Rithyodhya, the Academy of Performing Arts, to welcome our guests for the evening.
Om Sadguru Bhyo Namaha, Om Shri Sai Ram. Namaste, and a very warm welcome to all of you who have gathered to be part of the Young Researchers Forum organized by Nrityodaya, the Academy of Performing Arts Mumbai, and the Center of Excellence in Art and Culture, Shasun College for Women, Chennai. We are extremely fortunate to have our Guru, Dr. Padma Subramaniam to bless us in our first paper presentation today. My humble salutations to you, Paduka, and a very, very warm welcome. We are really blessed to have you for this first session of paper presentation. Our first young research scholar is Dr. Gayatri Kannan, who would be presenting a paper on Kumara Kampana, the forgotten hero in history. A very important aspect of historical facts of South India, which shows the period where there was a resurgence of all our fine arts, which we cherish today as the culture of South India, the Carnatic music and the dance. We are very grateful to Shatavdani Dr. R. Ganesh for having accepted to be with us today to give your expert observations and comments for validating and supporting Dr. Gayatri's presentation. Just a word about our this forum. We've been constantly coming in contact with a lot of youngsters who have very sincerely tried to delve deep into our ancient past, rerouting their ideas to our roots to show the relevance of our ancient knowledge to the present times. And these have been very worthy works. And for a long time, I've been wanting to create a platform to showcase these young research scholars' works. And I did initiate one this year, beginning through Abhay Mumbai Shakha, because we are in the 10th year of our association with Abhay Chennai. And of course, the present situation did not allow us to take it forward much more than one session where our expert was Nandini Ramaniji. But thankfully, Dr. Rajashri had also started something and she wanted to take it forward. And the management of Shashan College came forward to support us, and we've been able to initiate this with the blessings of my guru, Paduka, and Shekhar Senji, who inaugurated the first session. We've been having overwhelming response from both young scholars and the experts for supporting us. We want to take it forward as an ongoing online effort so that there is more visibility globally and participation from the rest of the world. We welcome each one of you again. A very warm welcome to Dr. Gayatri, Dr. Ganesh, Paduka, and all others who are present here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jayashree. I request Dr. Rajshri Vasudevan, Director, Center for Excellence, Art and Culture, Shasun Jain College, Chennai, to introduce our guests.
Aishwarya, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, Om Shri Sai Ram. My pranams to Dr. Padma Subramaniam, our guru, and Dr. Ganesh. It is said that you can be erudite with the knowledge of others. You can be wise only with your own wisdom, in the words of Montaigne. It is a good fortune that we have in our midst today an erudite and wise scholar as our expert, Shatavdani Dr. R. Ganesh. When we in these days forget even what we learned the earlier day, it is amazing how he can remember 100 things at the same time. And I will now proceed on this nearly impossible task of trying to condense the accomplishments of Dr. Ganesh
He has told me that I should not go into too much detail, and I can assure you that I can't do it as well because his bio data runs into several pages. The numerous fields that he has been associated with are poetics, prosody, literature, music, dance, and theater. Master of the ancient art of Avadhana, which is a classical literary art, an author in Sanskrit and Kannada, and an extempore poet in multiple languages. Only Shatavadhani from Karnataka. He has his Bachelor of Engineering in Mechanical Engineering, the Master of Science in Material Science and Metallurgy, Master of Arts in Sanskrit, and Doctor of Letters in Kannada. The awards and honors are many. A few of them already deal it from Tumkur University, 2010, Senior Fellowship, Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India, 2006-2008, Maharishi Badarayana Vyas Samman, President of India, 2003, Rajyotsava Award, Government of Karnataka, 1992, Rajyotsava Prashasti, Karnataka State Award in 1992, Badarayana Vyasa Puraskar, awarded by the President of India for contributions to Sanskrit for the year 2003, Sedayappu Award for the year 2010, Andhra Sahitya Vijnana Sangha Award in 2017, and Chit Prabhananda Award from the Royal Family of Mysore, 2011. The languages that he knows are many: Kannada, Telugu, Sanskrit, Prakrit, Pali, Tamil, English, Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati, Malayalam, Greek, Latin, and Italian. He has been kind enough to leave a few for other scholars in the field. In English, his writings are nearly 10, in Sanskritam 10, Kannada 5, poetic works 8, research works 23, and lectures of whopping 10,000 hours. So we truly have one of the most erudite scholars in our country today with us. Our young researcher, Dr. Gayatri Kannan. No great man lives in vain. The history of the world is but the biography of great men, said Thomas Carlyle. It is indeed the good fortune of Bharat that men and women of courage and conviction have risen time and again to fight the forces of destruction and re-establish moral order. One such is no doubt the swashbuckling hero of the Vijayanagar Empire, Kumara Kampanna. Accompanied by his fiery yet gracious wife, Ganga Devi, Kampanna led the expedition to Madurai and Srirangam, because of which we have the two temple towns in our midst. We have Dr. Gayatri Kannan to speak about this. A few words about Dr. Gayatri. She's a senior most disciple of Dr. Padma Subramanyam for dance and Vidwan Sri S. Rajam for music, Nritya Praveshika certificate, Nritya Visharada diploma from Nrityodaya, as also Nritya Shali, which is a post diploma certificate course, especially on the 108 Karanas of the Natyashastra. Academics, she has a master's degree in Sanskrit, MPhil in Saundarya Lahari and Shivananda Lahari, a comparative study. Her PhD was on this work that she is going to speak on today, that is Madhura Vijayam, a literary appreciation. Her research project was on Dhruva Ganam from the Natyashastra, and she's presently working on the reconstruction of Angaharas from the Natyashastra for her Tagore scholarship from the Government of India. She has several awards and titles to her credit, which sit very lightly on her shoulders. Yuvakala Bharati by Bharat Kalachar, 1993. Shyamala Balakrishnan Memorial Award in 2003. Nritya Chudamani from Sri Krishna Gana Sabha in 2014. Satya Gana Kokila Sundaram by Bharatanjali Trust. Abhyasa Nritya Vardhini from Abhyasa Academy of Classical Dance. She's presently the principal of Nrityodaya, handing classes in dance, practical, theory, Sanskrit, and music. She's traveled within India and abroad, including USA, Canada, UK, France, Portugal, Switzerland, Sri Lanka, Singapore, Malaysia, Cambodia, South Africa, and Australia. And despite being widely traveled, she's very much rooted and down to earth. I welcome both of them. I'm very happy that I was given this opportunity to introduce a stalwart like Dr. R. Ganesh, and our young researcher, Dr. Gayatri Kannan. Over to you, Gayatri. Thank you.
Can you hear me? Am I audible? Okay. So Sadgurubhyo Namaha. My pranams to my guru, Dr. Padma Subramanyam, who's the Aadhara Shruti in my life. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Jayashree Rajagopalan and Dr. Rajshree Vasudevan for having invited me to present this paper in this Young Researchers Forum. My namaskarams to Shatavdhani, Dr. R. Ganesh. I'm fortunate to present this paper in the presence of a blessed Saraswati Putra. The Jagatguru, Pujya Sri Chandrasekharendra Saraswati Swamigal, the 68th Shankaracharya of the Kanchi Kamakoti Peetham, has spoken in his Devatin Kural about the great saint Vidyaranya, who founded the Vijayanagara Empire with Harihara and Bukka as the kings. The Mahaswami of Kanchi mentions Kampana, Bukka's son, and his importance in the resurrection of our Sanatana Dharma during the Muslim invasion. In this context, he praises Ganga Devi, Kampana's queen, and her work, Madhura Vijayam, which is a small poetic travelogue extolling the exploits of Kumara Kampana and his victory over the Sultanate of Madurai. When I registered for my PhD at the Madras University, my guru, Paduka, suggested that I take up this work of Ganga Devi mentioned by Mahaswami and work on it as it is not widely known. This work belongs to the 14th century. In the words of the poetess Ganga Devi herself, she says in Madhura Vijayam, Shrutihi asmita nayah pralinu virata dharma katha chyutam charitram sukritam gatam abhijatyam astam kimivanyata kalireka eva dhanyaha. The Kali age deserves now deepest congratulations for being at the zenith of its power, for gone is sacred learning, hidden is refinement, hushed is the voice of dharma, destroyed is discipline, and discounted is nobility of birth. This seems to be relevant to this day. During such a bleak situation, this young, vibrant prince Kampana emerged like a sun, driving away the darkness created by the Muslim invasion, or Turushka invasion, as Ganga Devi calls them. This presentation today attempts to bring to light the importance and greatness of this unsung hero, who has been unfortunately forgotten or intentionally suppressed by both the historical and literary fields. As Kanchi Mahaswami says, if not for this one Prince Kampana, the entire southern peninsula would have turned Islamic. He has protected our temples from turning into monuments and brought back to life our culture and religion. Before going into the actual details of Kampana's contribution, it is important to understand the psychological provocation that led to the conquest of the Madurai Sultanate in Tamil Nadu. The Tamil country, which had been under the Pallavas, Cheras, Cholas, and the Pandyas, did have clashes and battles with proverbial rivalry. The period between 1250 to 1274 BCE is very complicated to comprehend and full of turmoil because of the fact that after the fall of the Chola Empire, there was hardly any dynasty or political power which was strong enough to safeguard the security of the Tamil country. The Muslim rule in Delhi was getting stronger, and their eyes had already fallen on the wealth of the southern kingdoms. The instability in the south turned as an advantage for them for an easy entry into the southern region. This period is of utmost importance for the study of the significance of Madhura Vijayam, and the historicity of the events narrated in this work needs to be corroborated from the point of view of epigraphical evidences apart from literary sources. In 1294 BCE, Alauddin Khilji, hearing about the enormous wealth of the Yadavas, attacked Devagiri, which is now Daulatabad near Aurangabad. This was the onset of Muslim invasion towards south. In 1310 BCE, Malik Kafur, the general of this Delhi Sultan, who, in the words of Wasif, a poet in the Persian court, was the very Saturn. He marched against south, looted all the temples and destroyed them. From then onwards, it had been a continuous rule of the Muslim Sultanate till Kampana arrived. It was in 1323 BCE that Muhammad bin Tughlaq, a name which symbolized terror, captured Warangal Fort and imprisoned Raja Prataparudra. At the same time, there was another invasion of south in which a viceroyalty of the Delhi Sultan was established in Madurai. In 1334 BCE, Jalaluddin, taking advantage of the distance that separated Madurai and Delhi, put an end to this viceroyalty and became the independent ruler of Madurai. He ruled for 5 years and then he was succeeded by Ghayasuddin. 1336 BCE, the year in which the brothers Harihara and Bukka were made the kings of the Vijayanagara dynasty, founded with the blessings of Saint Vidyaranya. Harihara ruled, while Bukka extended the kingdom through campaigns. 1342 BCE saw the fall of the Hoysala kingdom. Ballala III, who had by then equipped himself with a huge army, marched against the Muslims and fought a battle at Kannanur. The Mohammedans, realizing the strength of the Ballala army and unable to face them, begged for an armistice. Ballala, who was used to warfare based on Hindu Dharma Shastra, accepted. But he was cheated. When the armistice was observed, it is said that the Sultan violated and captured Ballala. After having drained him of his wealth, he was inhumanly put to death. The Muslim historian Ibn Battuta, who was a contemporaneous to this period, says, quote, Ballala's skin was stuffed with straw and hung up on the wall of Madurai, where I saw it in the same position, unquote. With such atrocities happening, Bukka captured the Hoysala territory, and in 1352 BCE, Kumara Kampana, a young prince then, started his campaign towards Tamil Nadu and stayed in Tiruvannamalai. In 1362 BCE, he established the Vijayanagara overlordship in the Shambhuvaraya territory and ruled from Kanchipuram for nearly 10 years. 1371 BCE. This was the eventful year when Kampana put an end to the Sultanate in Madurai. According to an inscription of Maravarman II, found in Tirukkallakudi, dated September 12, 1371, Kampana is said to have, quote, killed the Sultan in a battle and established orderly government, unquote. It is a wonderful coincidence that 649 years later, in the same month of September, we are remembering this warrior, Kampana. This is a very brief history of the political turmoil that prevailed during that period, thus leading to the Vijaya of Madurai. Now, political conquests are not new or unseen in our country. South India has seen the rise and fall of many kings, where the weaker ones were subjected or even killed, and the mightier ones took over. But never in the history of Hindu empires did one king loot or destroy the temples in the enemy kingdom. In fact, the victory in many places would be commemorated by building one more gopuram or a mantapa in the temple present in the annexed territory, or by giving grants to Brahmins and temples. This was their dharma. This is in sharp contrast to the ideals of the Mohammedan invaders. To quote Reverend H. Heras and V.K. Bhandarkar, they say, quote, there, that is the Mohammedans, invasion was mainly impelled by a love for gold of the southern kingdoms and the fanatic zeal to spread Islam, unquote. So the first thing they did was to raise to ground the temples and loot all the wealth. Madurai was under Muslim rule for nearly 48 years, 1323 to 1371 BCE. Ibn Battuta, the Moorish traveler, gives us frightful details of how the people suffered during the period of the Mohammedan invasion. He was an eyewitness to these. Amir Khusrow gives an account of the pathetic plight of a temple in the Tamil country during Malik Kafur's invasion. He says, quote, in Brahmastapuri, there was a golden idol around which many elephants were stabled. The Malik started on a night expedition against this place and in the morning seized no less than 250 elephants. He then determined on razing the beautiful temple to ground. The roof was covered with rubies and emeralds. The Malik dug this up from its foundation with the greatest care. The heads of the Brahmins and idolaters danced from their necks and fell to the ground at their feet. The stone image called Linga Mahadev, which had been long time established at that place, up to this time, the kick of the horse of Islam had not attempted to break, unquote. Brahmastapuri, according to Sanu Kainikara, is Chidambaram. Several inscriptions have been found referring to the damages done to temples. One such inscription from Kannanur, the capital of the Hoysala state, states that the temple of Posalishwaram Udayar was destroyed up to the Aadhara Shilai and converted into a mosque. It was only after Kampana's conquest that the temple was reconstructed. When temples were closed or destroyed, it meant that our arts too came to an end, as the temple was the focal center of all our arts. It was at such a dark period when our religion, art, and culture suffered a downfall that Kampana rose to put an end to a violence which was not just physical, but a violence to heritage and faith. With this background, let me now move on to the story of our hero, Kumara Kampana. Madhura Vijayam is the story of this Veera Kamparaya, written by Kampana's queen, Ganga Devi, who was an Andhra princess. This kavya has 9 cantos or sargas. It starts with the birth of Kampana to King Bukka, who ruled over the Vijayanagara dynasty, and is completed with the conquest of the Sultan. It is obvious that she had traveled with him during this campaign. This work stands a real testimony to the definition of Kavya as given by Mammata. Ganga Devi's versatility reflects throughout the work. It conforms to all rules of a Mahakavya as laid down in the treatises on poetics and contains the usual description of moonrise, twilight, seasons, etc. However, I am not going into the literary aspects of this work due to paucity of time. I'll delve more into the historical evidence that we find. Ganga Devi devotes one whole sarga for the description of Pampa, the capital of Vijayanagara, and this is Hampi of the present times. The two main historic events which are described in detail in this work are the defeat of the Shambhuvarayar king and Sultan of Madurai. She vividly describes how both the kings were killed by Kampana in the battle. These two events can be corroborated with evidences from inscription and other temple documents. The Koyil Orugu is a unique work in Tamil which gives the history of Lord Sri Ranganatha's temple at Srirangam. Koyil in the Vaishnava tradition refers to the Srirangam temple. Orugu is defined as a register of a temple giving an account of its properties and its history. This work gives details like the growth of the temple, acquisition of wealth through benefactions and grants from various kings and other devotees. The Koyil Orugu is relevant to this study as it reveals the details regarding certain historic events connected with the campaign that Kampana undertook in the Tamil country. The book traces the history of Srirangam temple from the time of Vibhishana to the end of 18th century BCE. Regarding Kampana and his victory over Madurai, the Koyil Urugu gives two reliable dates. It mentions 1327 BCE as the one in which the Mohammedan invasion of the south took place. Similarly, 1371 BCE, that is the year in which Kampana put an end to the Muslim rule in Madurai, is mentioned as the year in which Srirangam was completely cleared of its Muslim occupants and the idols were reinstated. A detailed account of how the idol of Lord Ranganatha was saved from the Muslim invaders and taken to various places of safety, and finally, how Gopanna, a Brahmin general of Kampana, ruling from Senji Fort, restored the idol back in Srirangam, is very clearly given in this work. This has been one of the primary sources of information for a correlated study of Madura Vijayam. Madurai Thala Varalaru and Sthanikar Thala Varalaru. These two works, like Koyil Urugu, gives details about the wealth, property, and the grants given by the kings to the Madurai Meenakshi temple. In the Madurai Thala Varalaru, there is a mention of Kampana as having killed the Sultan and restored the Meenakshi temple in all its glory. Here, there is a reference to a very touching incident. After killing the Sultan, Kampana went to the Meenakshi temple to have darshan of the goddess. To save the original idol of goddess Meenakshi from being destroyed by the Muslims, an artificial wall had been built in front of the original idol in order to hide it. Another duplicate idol had been placed in front of this wall. Kampana, after killing the Sultan, ordered this wall to be removed to facilitate resumption of worship for the original idol after a gap of 4 decades. When the wall was broken, Kampana was delighted to see that the Chandana Kapu, that is the decoration with sandalwood paste, which had been applied for the goddess on the day the artificial wall was built, that is 40 years before, was still fresh as if it was done just then. Kampana was ecstatic. The Madurai Thala Varalaru says that Kampana was in ecstasy when he saw this miracle, and in a devotional frenzy, he beat his cheeks with his palm. It says, Kannathil Araindu Kondan. Ganga Devi, in her Madura Vijayam, writes about one particular incident which actually kindled Kampana to march against the Madurai Sultanate. The 8th canto starts with an incomplete verse, and one knows not as to how many verses have been lost earlier to this incomplete verse. It starts with a description of the pathetic state of the various temples like Srirangam, Madurai, and Vyaghrapuri or Puliyur, which is Chidambaram. Worship had been stopped in all these places. The verses say, quote, in Srirangam, the Lord of Serpents was warding off the heaps of brick with the hood, lest their fall should disturb the yoga nidra of Hari, who is worshipped there. The foldings of the doors were eaten up by woodworms. Those temples which were resonant with the sounds of mridanga drums were now echoing with the fearful howls of jackals. The river Kaveri became deflected very much from her time-honored course and was flowing in all wrong directions, imitating the ruthless invaders. The Brahmin streets were where once the sacrificial smoke was seen rising and the chanting of the Vedas always greeted the ear, now sent out the musty odor of meat and resounded with the war cries of the drunken marauders. The groves of Madurai had all been destroyed. The coconut trees had all been cut, and in their places were to be seen rows of iron spikes with human heads sticking at the points. the waters of the Tamraparani, which were white with a sandal paste washed from the breasts of charming maidens, were now flowing red with the blood of cows slaughtered by the miscreants. Vyagrapuri has indeed become the abode of the Vyagras, or the bloodthirsty tigers. Unquote. Towards the end of this description, we see that all this is said by a divine lady whose identity is not known due to the missing verses. She then gives the prince a special divine sword, which she says she received from Agastya Muni. The Pandya kings were supposed to have received this sword from Lord Shiva himself. But as time passed, the Pandyas became very weak, and the last Pandya king was neither very strong nor efficient. Hence, Agastya, realizing this, sent the sword through this divine lady to be given to Kampana. The lady assures that Kampana had the valor, zeal, and efficiency in him to put down the Muslims. She praises the prince and says that with Kampana's rule, there would be peace, happiness, and prosperity everywhere. Here too, the last few manuscript leaves are missing. Unfortunately, the verses describing this lady and any other details regarding her name is missing. It is not clear as to whether it was a dream or reality. It is likely that Ganga Devi took her to be Goddess Durga or Goddess Meenakshi, who was herself a warrior princess. In the 9th canto, the final canto, more than 100 verses are lost. However, this canto starts with the fight scene in the battlefield. A gruesome detailed description of the fight between the Muslim army and the army of Kampana is given here. There are some interesting descriptions. Just for an example, Ganga Devi says, two soldiers from both Kampana's camp and the Muslim camp fought and beheaded each other. Once they died, however, they were no longer enemies, and they joined hands and traveled together to heaven. She describes the valor of both Kampana and the Muslim Sultan. She also brings in Kampana's greatness and magnanimity when we see him appreciating and admiring the Sultan's valor. Finally, the prince destroyed the Yavana's flag and bowstring. Then Kampana used the divine sword given by Agastya and beheaded the Yavana king. This canto is incomplete, and it is not known as to what happened after the battle. However, as the Turushka had been killed, not much could have been lost. With this, the work gets completed. An inscription from Tiruvannamalai belonging to Kampana's son, Jamana Udayar, dated December 17, 1374, mentions the creation of an endowment in the name of Kampana Udayar in the village Kamparaya Chaturvedi Mangalam in Adayur Nadu for Veda Adhyayanam for one person. So this shows that Kampana must have died just before this date, that is December 17, 1374. By 1380 BCE, the Vijayanagara conquest of the south was complete. The empire extended from River Krishna in the north to Cape Comorin in the south, and from Arabian Sea to the Bay of Bengal. This empire, which symbolized everything that was best in South Indian culture, thus saved and resurrected every facet of Hindu heritage and culture. Dharma eva hato hanti, dharmo rakshati rakshitaha, tasmat dharmo nahantavyo, mano dharmo hatovadhit. Dharma destroys those who try to destroy it. Dharma protects when protected. Therefore, never destroy dharma, and dharma will not destroy. These words of Manu were not only relevant during his time and later during Kampana's time, but are relevant to this day. One can say that the life of Kumara Kampana and this Kavyam Madhura Vijayam is summarized in this one verse. The invaders did not make just a territorial conquest, but an attack on the culture and religion of our country. Kumara Kampana's conquest was not only for expanding the Vijayanagara territory, but also to protect our Sanatana Dharma. As an ideal ruler, he felt the responsibility towards not only his own subjects, but the people of entire South India. For the South Indian people, Kampana was not an invader, he was a savior. Unfortunately, he did not live long after his victory over the Madurai Sultanate. It is surprising that the annals of history do not find the name of this great hero who was responsible for the resurrection of our Dharma. In fact, when one speaks of Vijayanagara dynasty, one remembers Harihara, Bukka, and then jumping a few centuries, one remembers Krishna Devaraya. There is no mention of this heroic prince Kampana. An inscription from Tirukkallakudi states, quote, "At this juncture, Kampana Udayar came on his southern campaign, destroyed the Tulukan, established orderly government throughout the country, and appointed many chiefs, Nayakanmar, for inspection and supervision in order that the worship in all temples might be revived regularly as of old," unquote. So he didn't come about with the campaign for his own sake, but for the establishment of Dharma. To quote Dr. Padma Subramanyam from her book, Natyashastra and National Unity, quote, "The classical music of even Tamil Nadu, which has its own grammar and tradition, as seen in the Tevaram hymns, also came to be referred as Karnataka Sangeetam because it was revived by the Karnataka king Kampana under the spiritual guidance of Swami Vidyaranya. The habit of referring to anything classical or an age-old custom as Karnatakam in Tamil Nadu was also because of this," unquote. The 13th and 14th centuries are said to be a dark period about which nothing much is known. This seems to be a dark period for Kampana too, whose name is yet to see limelight. This work, Madura Vijayam, is a very small book glorifying his achievements. But for this book, Kampana would have been lost as an unsung hero. Though many manuscript leaves are missing, the fragrance of that period is still fresh when one reads it. The way of life, the culture, religion, and social conditions of that period are known through a careful study of this work. In fact, in pre-independence India, this work was studied as non-detailed for Sanskrit examinations in Travancore. In the Madras University also, this book was used for BA degree exam. This work is very important in the present context for the present generation, for it helps increase the reverence for the achievements of our ancestors. The Madura Vijayam will inspire the common Hindu psyche and destroy the linguistic barriers created by our politicians as a legacy of the British divide and rule policy. In short, this Kavya echoes the traditional Hindu concept of equality for women in matters concerning not only property, but intellectualism, bravery, and artistry as reflected in this unique travelogue of Ganga Devi. When the true history is written, hopefully Madura Vijayam will also find a right place of recognition. I once again thank Dr. Jayashree Rajagopalan and Dr. Rajshree Vasudevan for giving me this opportunity. Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gayatri Kannan, for giving a very quick but fairly exhaustive overview of Madura Vijayam. And we are now looking forward to the inputs, observations, and comments of Dr. Ganesh. Dr. Ganesh, please request you to address the gathering. Thank you.
Mahakavi Mukham Koja Manipanjara Sharikam Chaitanya Jaladhir Jyotsram Devim Vande Saraswatim. This is how our Ganga Devi starts praising Goddess Saraswati in her Madura Vijayam or Veera Kampana Raya Charitam. Mahakavi Mukhambhoja Manipanjara Sharikam. She is like a pet parrot residing in the cages, which are nothing but the minds of great poets. And she is like the moonlight that makes the Chaitanya, our consciousness, the ocean, to rise. And its waves will leap and dance because of her moonlight like grace. So she praises Saraswati. I'm very happy that Dr. Gayatri Kannan has given a very beautiful, succinct, and comprehensive understanding of the epic as well as the great personality Kumara Kampana or Veera Kampana Raya. I'm very happy. I have nothing but appreciation for that mellifluous presentation, very much comparable to her musical rendition. Vistaram asandigdham avilambitam adbhutam uchcharayati kalyani vacham hridayaharini. So says Lord Sri Rama when he was listening to the words of Hanuman when he first met with him on the banks of Pampa, which is the sacred lake present even today in Pampa or Hampi. And that's how Hanuman's words were praised by Rama. And I have to use the same words of Adikavi Valmiki. Avistaram, it is not diary of words. And asandigdham, very objective, clear, precise, and pinpointed. Avilambita madhurtam, it was not dragged. It was neither hurried nor dragged. Uchcharayati kalyani vacham, very pleasant utterance, hridayaharini, very much engaging and arresting all our hearts and thoughts. That's why I'm very much beholden to Shrimati Jayashree Rajagopalji and other people for enthusiastic in organizing this. Thank you. And I also feel very much grateful for having given me this opportunity to share a few of these historical details and other poetic details. I have nothing more to comment on the presentation of our Gayatri. Well, as I come from Karnataka, from where the great expedition started, and I'm also very much interested in Swami Vidyaranya's works. I had written and published a book on the life and contribution of Vidyaranya to Indian culture, and it is now being translated into English also. Once it is ready, I think it will be available for the people who are unable to follow Kannada. Vidyaranya and his younger brother, just 1 year younger to him, Sayanacharya, these two brothers, they were like two eyes of our Indian culture and particularly South Indian culture. But for these two brothers, we would have lost so many things. The whole empire of Vijayanagar was not ruled by a king. The seal of Vijayanagar goes in the name of Virupaksha. Means the king is the Lord Virupaksha and not the mortal king. And so the seal goes by the name Virupaksha, and hence it was ruled. And then, as Kaitri mentioned, unfortunately, after the two Sangama brothers, Harihara and Bukka, or Hakka and Bukka as they call, immediately we jump to Krishnadevaraya. There were other people. For example, Proudhadevaraya of the 15th century was there. That was a very great warrior, Proudhaprasapi. And he was protector of all sorts of culture, including so many poets who came from different nooks and corners of India. And he was a great warrior. And many travelers also visited, for example, Abdul Razak visited during that time. And Vijayanagar, it perpetuated the broad-based Sanatana Dharmic culture, which is all inclusive. No language unitism was seen. An example we can very clearly understand. Krishnadevaraya, whose mother tongue was Tulu, that language which is spoken even today in coastal Karnataka, and he was hailed as Kannada Ramaramana. So he ruled from the Kannada province and took a theme from Tamil Nadu and wrote an epic in Telugu, Amukta Malyada. And it is full of Sanskrit. So many Sanskritized verses are seen. In that sense, language was never a problem. It was a solution to so many problems. and also the aspect of music and dance. Not many people know that Vidyaranya Swami, he first wrote a music treatise which included dance also. In those days, Sangeeta was not just restricted to music. Gitam, Dattam, Tatha, Vadhyam, Trayam, Sangeeta, Muchyate. Thus goes the dictum of Sangeeta Ratnakara. Sauryatrikam, Nritya, Gitam, Vadhyam, Natyam, Idam, Trayam. So says Samarkosha. And then the Sangeeta Sara, which he wrote, unfortunately lost, has been quoted in parts, in fragments, by another great person who hailed from the same lineage of Vidyaranya, who belonged to Tanjavur, that is Govinda Dikshita. We know legendary personality he was and his great contributions, and he was a philanthropist as well. And his son is Venkatamakhi. And Govinda Dikshita was also a great musicologist, and he wrote Sangeeta Sudha. In Sangeeta Sudha, fragments of Sangeeta Sara of Swami Vidyaranya are preserved. And to our pleasant astonishment, the Mela Paddhati, as propounded by Venkatamakhi and perfected by Govindacharya later, finds its roots in Vidyaranya Sangeeta Sara. Before that, our music was Grama Paddhati, and a shift from Grama to Mela for betterment was done by Swami Vidyaranya. And also, the very same Vijayanagar, Hampi, that place was the birthplace of another great musicologist of 7th century, was Matanga. His Brihadeshi, after Natyashastra, is the most important and earliest work in musicology. Like that, we have so many works. And also, Kalinatha, Kallaya of Vijayanagar, wrote a wonderful commentary, Sangeeta Kalanidhi, on Sangeeta Ratnakara of Shardadeva. In that way, so many musicians and musicologists, they worked under the patronage of Vijayanagar, and perhaps for that reason, our music system was came to be known as Karnataka Sangeeta. And also, Vijayanagar people, they, apart from building temples, they enhanced and fortified our temples. Before that, all our temples were not so big, encircled by big prakaram, towering gopurams and all. That gopuram is called Raya Gopuram. Again, the credits are going to Vijayanagar people, Raya. Because they thought that these invaders, ruthlessly, they were destroying and massacring all our culture, and hence our temples have to be fortified. That's why very big and strong, tall prakarams were built. And also, earlier, most of our temples in Karnataka, they were built not by granite. They were built by using sandstone and soapstone. They yield good lot of carving. They give lot of facility for beautiful filigree work in stone. But granite is very hard. But longevity, strength, and robustness are the qualities of granite. That's why, in spite of that becoming a hard nut to crack, Vijayanagar people propagated this way. In that way, they saw so much. And in South India, we don't find in sculpture daily life in a vivid manner. And also, amusements and common entertainments and folk features in vividity. Only in the period of Vijayanagar, we find a lot of sculptures, especially bas reliefs in various temples, on the pillars of the temples. For example, Mahanavami Dibba, the well-known platform in Hampi, on which the Vijayanagar rulers used to sit and they used to watch the Vijayadashmi festivals and march past and other things. And really, Vijayadashmi was the Republic Day of ancient India. And all those beautiful things are carved there. We can see Kolatam there. And we can see Holika, the Madanotsava. And in Vijayanagar, Madanotsava or Vasantotsava was very, very popular. And one poet from later Vijayanagar period, Ramaraj Bhushana, who has written a scholarly poem called Vasucharitram in Telugu, was known as Sangeeta Rahasya Kalanidhi. He gives so many details regarding music in his work. And there he says how before Vasanta, the Raga Hindolam used to be sung, which was devoid of Panchama and Shajja. While the advent of Vasanta, Vasanta Raga used to be sung. In those days, Vasanta used to have both Panchama and Shadja. Those are the details we get. And he beautifully employs the pun, Sariga Panchamamam Vasangi Padini. Means Sariga means with Sari, with Ri. Sariga, Sari, Rishabena Saitam, Sariga, Panchamam. With Panchama is the embodiment of Kuku, Panchamam, Kokipika, Kujati Panchamam, like that our Kosha goes. So many things were well knit in Vijayanagar. And also, Vidyaranya Swamiji, he took so much of trouble to see that Sanatana Dharma is perpetuated without any hindrance. Many people were forcefully converted, polluted, and so many things were happened. And that's why Vidyaranya's younger brother Sayanacharya wrote a work called Prayaschitta Sudhani. One has to feel that I am pure, I am coming back to the folds of Sanatana Dharma once again, like that. So that feeling has to be brought out. That's why Prayaschittam were given. And in Vidyaranya Swami's Panchadashi, we find a reference. If forceful conversions are made, we can get back those people again to the fold of Sanatana Dharma. He says, a Brahmin being converted to Islam, once he comes back to Hinduism, he again becomes Brahmin. So also, a Jiva in ignorance is termed as Jiva. When once it gets liberated, it will become Brahman. That analogy he gives. And also, there are some records which shows that the five Sangama brothers, Harihara, Bukkaraya, and then another Kampana, our Kampana warrior, Kumara Kampana was Kampana the second. First Kampana was younger brother of Harihara. Next to him was Bukkaraya. And the fourth was Marappa. And fifth was Muddappa. Harihara ruled from Hampi. While first Kampana ruled from Udayagiri of Andhra. And then Marappa, he conquered Goa and other places in coastal Karnataka. And with him, one Madhava Mantri went. He is the author of Sutta Samhita. Another scholar, he belongs to Angirasa Gotra. While Vidyaranya Swamiji belongs to Bharadvaja Gotra. I am saying, so many scholars and so many warriors, they protected Sanatana Dharma. And the youngest brother, it is Muddappa, was working with the Harihara as his bodyguard like that. And among these brothers, some were forced to Islam, it seems. So goes the legend in Vidyaranya Kalajnanam. It is similar to the work of Nostradamus. So many soothsaying and fortune sayings have been recorded there. And Vidyaranya Swamiji, he made them come back to the fold of Sanatana Dharma. That's how they had so much of respect for Vidyaranya and his younger brother Sayanacharya. And Sayanacharya wrote, with the help of so many scholars, first ever commentary on all the four Vedas, including all the four aspects of Vedas, Samhita, Brahmanya, Aranyaka, and Upanishad, to all available shakhas also he wrote. That is a titanic task. It took decades from the period of Harihara to the period of Harihara the second, Bukkaraya's another son who succeeded Bukkaraya, to that span of more than four decades that work went on. So I am saying this thing, so many things happened. And in Vijayanagar, no religious rivalry, no sectarian fights happened. Everything was so well taken care of. In the time of Bukkaraya, there was a fight between Sri Vishnavas and Jains regarding some temple procession. Then Bukkaraya went there, settled the dispute, and the inscriptions are seen very close to Bangalore. There is a place called Kalya, something like 30 kilometers from Bangalore. And also in Shravanabelagola, renowned place of Jains. In those places, inscriptions are erected, and it is said, Jains should contribute for the temple festival of Sri Vaishnava, and Sri Vaishnavas in turn should contribute for the festivals of Basadi. Basadi is the temple of Jain. Like that, mutual coordination and mutual cooperation and mutual respect was again harbored. And not to speak about the poetic talents of Gangadevi. In one of the cantos, Kumara Kampana requests her to describe the moonrise and sunset and also nature. in various seasons. Then Sarasodharapada Saraswati. This, your words are Sarasa, full of rasa, and Udara, not an element of cheapness, not an element of baldness is seen. That is the caliber of Ganga Devi. I've gone through almost all the poetesses who are seen in the lore of Sanskrit, starting from Pulikeshi II's daughter-in-law, Vijika or Vijayambika, up to 18th century. I have gone through all the available poetesses of Sanskrit, but Ganga Devi comes first. After Kalidasa, I think, in lucid diction of Vaidarbhi, she is the best, I think. There is a great scholar by name Potukuchi Subramani Shastri from Andhra Pradesh, who has written a wonderful Sanskrit commentary on Mathura Vijayam. And he too agrees with this point and elaborates in greater detail. And he has translated that with annotated notes into Telugu also. And he has written a Telugu novel on Ganga Devi. And unfortunately, a complete translation of Mathura Vijayam in English is not available yet. A brief translation of Mathura Vijayam into English, select 300 verses, have been done by my friend Dr. R. Shankar Rajaraman. There, that is available in the archives also. Ganga Devi's diction is very faithful to history. At the same time, her imagination is amazing, amazing. When she writes, how when the sun is set, what are the changes that happen in nature, and how the moonlight emerges. The crescent moon looks like a plow, and night is plowing in the yard of sky, and then stars are the seeds. They are sown only to reap the harvest of moonlight, like that. And sun is falling into the ocean. That is the description of dusk. Then Ravi Rujjit Ambaraha. Ambara means garment and also sky. He is coming away from the sky. He is losing his garment. And he is falling. He is slipping. And also, why it has happened? He has drunk the wine from the goblets of lotuses. And that's why Madhupitva Ravi Rujjit Ambaraha, having drunk Madhu, has lost control on himself. And Namada Kasya Vikara Karanam, Mada intoxication will even make a great person like sun also fall. Like that, such a beautiful way of puns. And when the lotuses have closed in the evening, a bee is bumbling and moving around the closed lotus. It says, Ghatamana Dalar Ari Putam, like that. The poet says, the lotus is, of course, the abode of Lakshmi. And when Lakshmi is within that, it is something like a bank is closed and the beat police is whistling and moving around and to see that it is saved properly. That's how the bumbling bee is moving all around. In that way, vivid and picturesque descriptions are very many. At the same time, it's one of the rare heroic works. Usually, it is rare to find Veera Kavya. We have many Shringara Kavyas and Bhakti Kavyas in Sanskrit. Ganga Devi is a rare exception in the genre. And also, contemporary theme has been taken and it has been taken to the level of an epic. It is a Mahakavya. But unfortunately, we are unable to get the complete work. As mentioned by Gayatri, a few portions are broken here and there. And we don't know how many cantos it had. But as per the dictum of Vishwanatha and other poeticians, 8 cantos are minimum required for a Mahakavya. In that sense also, Ganga Devi's work has now available 9 cantos. By that itself, we can declare it as a Mahakavya. And in the beginning, she praises all great poets and gives her concept of poetry. What is the concept of poetry? Like that. There are many logicians, there are many grammarians. Tarkika bhava santi, shabdikascha sastrashaha, kavayo viralaloke, saralalapa peshalaha. Scholars are very many in the world. But creative artists are very few. And hence, you people are mainly creative artists. May your lore, may your fraternity multiply in large number, both in quality and quantity. We shall revive our Sanatana Dharma. With these few words, I conclude my deliberations. Thank you.
I just would like to add one thing. Thank you, Anna, for those very, very kind words that you spoke. I feel really blessed coming from you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
There was one Professor Tiruvenkatachari. He has written an entire translation of this work. Actually, yes, into English.
Oh, God.
What happened is I submitted my synopsis. And then I came to know that he was living in Chennai only.
Uh-huh.
So I went to him. I went to him for classes and I studied Madhura Vijayam under him for some time.
Uh-huh.
At that time, he was 90 and odd years.
Oh, it's a good news. But did he publish his translation?
Yes, I got the translation from him. Uh-huh. But I don't know if it's available now.
When it was translated, then published?
It was 1957.
1957? Yes. God. Oh,
you said. He was 91 or something when I went to him, 2001.
1957. Tiruvenkatachari?
Yes.
Oh.
He was a professor in Dr. Aragappa Chettiar Training College in Karaikudi.
Uh-huh.
So I have to know that he was there. So I went and met him. I went for classes.
Thank you. Thanks for making me know about this detail. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ganesh. I mean, it was like what we call in Tamil as an arivi, like a cataract. That information was just coming out of you, overflowing from you. And I know you have just controlled yourself so that we can get on with the questions. It was obvious. So we have a few questions here, if we can take them now. There are some for Dr. Gayatri. I'll read out one by one and you can probably answer them. The first one is, would you say that back then women were very liberated to acquire skills and make decisions on their own, giving the example of Ganga Devi?
In our country, according to our dharma, women were always liberated. From the time of the Vedas, where we have Gargi, Maitreyi, they were all equal to those sages who lived during that time. And Gargi was somebody who was called to act as a judge for few other sages, more as a competition, where she was called to judge who was the, Brahmanishta. So women were given respect. And even later, even before Ganga Devi, as Dr. Ganesh mentioned, there have been many, many women poets in our country. And if we take our Tamil country, during Rajaraja Chola's period, his own sister, Kundabai, she was taken into consideration whenever Rajaraja had to take any major decisions. So women were always given importance in all matters, whether it was home or the state, the kingdom. They were always given importance. I guess Avayar, we have many of these saint poets. Avayar, Akka Mahadevi, they were all rebels. Meera, we have so many of them. And I think after the Muslim rule, women had to be protected. I think it was from then onwards that it was not subjugation, definitely not. It was more that they needed the protection from the from certain other people who were trying to take advantage. So I think that that was the cause for whatever is the present period or present state of women in our country. But originally, women were given equal importance or even more importance than men, I think so. Even they were also given a Gayatri mantram. Of course, a mantra I heard was a little different from what the men used to recite. But women were also given Upanayana. Women were also given Gayatri mantram. They had equal rights in everything.
The next question is, are the details mentioned in Madhura Vijayam also available in other texts of the same period? That is expedition details.
Other texts
of details of the expedition, are they also mentioned in other texts of the same period? Or is it a unique work where only Ganga Devi has mentioned about the expedition?
There are, I can give you a few texts which have mentioned Kampana's expedition. Apart from the inscriptions and the other inscriptions and what I mentioned, like Koyil Urugu, Thala Varalaru. Apart from these, there are a few works which have mentioned Kampana's expedition also. There are a few works. I can just check and tell you. During that period, not a detailed description of what Kampana did. But Kampana is definitely mentioned in one or two other works also, like Shalavabhyudhaya, where I believe Kampana is mentioned. But though the importance which Madhura Vijayam gives is not given in that work. But there is a mention of Kampana's expedition that he killed the Madurai Sultan. All that is mentioned. But I think it's more in the inscriptions and in works like Koyil Urugu, which are documents of the temples, which have documented his contribution.
It is in the Tamil Nadu inscriptions we find more reference to Kampana than in the inscriptions of Karnataka. Perhaps he was no more after completion. He died, perhaps. Unfortunately, he died. Perhaps in Tamil Nadu itself, he would have died. And that's why we don't.
He died in Tiruvannamalai. He was in Tiruvannamalai when he died.
Yes.
He reinstated a young Pandya prince in Madurai. Then he went to Tiruvannamalai. But he didn't live long. Like, as I mentioned, there is an endowment in his name in 1374. So after the Madurai's the invasion, maybe another 3 or 4 years, he would have been alive. That's all.
There is a question about what were the dance forms which were prevalent during that period?
Dance forms, actually, it couldn't have been prevalent. As I said, see, temple was always the focal center for any of our arts, whether it was music, dance, sculpture. Temple was the place where everything was centered around. So during the Muslim invasion, when all the temples were closed, obviously people were more worried about their own lives than dance or music. So during that period, everything was forgotten. For almost 40, 45 years, everything was forgotten. It was only after the Muslim invasion that slowly these forms started, scholars started with their memory, they started reconstructing what would have been there before the Muslim invasion. So during this period, during the Muslim invasion period, I don't think there could have been any art forms which were prevalent at all.
It is said in the Madhura Vijayam, even the parrots were made to speak in Persian. And poetess Ganga Devi says, what more agony can fall on us when our parents, pet parents, also speaking Persian and not our regional languages and Sanskrit. To that extent, the drastic change has happened. And where the Vedic recitations used to go on, there the Veda Vidwans were chained and were dragged, and the crackling sound of the chains are heard and not the Vedic hymns which were chanted.
There are a few, Ganesh, possibility of reviving the Hampi temples to rekindle the faith of the Hindus. So this has been asked by Ms. Aishwarya Harish. Is there a possibility?
Hampi's temple, of course, now in the recent years, it has been declared as part of the World Heritage, Smithsonian World Heritage. It has been given a lot of facelift. And many of the temples, they are completely demolished. And even the images are broken. As per tradition, we cannot worship a vigraham which has been deformed. The great Lakshmi Narasimha and the Ganapatis, all these are not worshipable. But at the same time, the Virupaksha still is being worshipped, and every year temple festivals go on, and on the temple ceiling you can find the painting of Vidyaranya also being carried in a palanquin. And those who are interested in knowing how the temple festival of Virupaksha is to go on during the spring season, a Sanskrit Champu Kavya, prose verse Kavyam, by name Virupaksha Vasantotsava Champu, authored by Ahobila, belonging to the same period, is available. And there you get a lot of description and a very beautiful vivid detail regarding that is available there. But the temples, they cannot be reinstated in this sense, because the images are lost. For example, the Krishna temple and the Vijayavithala temple, there the Mula Virat, the image itself is lost. So they have to remain forever as cautions.
There is a question. What is the reason for the downfall of the Vijayanagar Empire to the extent of becoming a total ruin after having been at its peak for so many years?
There are two reasons. One main thing is our military was not strong. Whenever Indian military was strong, whenever Indian power, the brute power was weak, invaders had an upper hand. During the time of Proudhadeva Raya, before that, during the time of Bukka Raya, next Proudhadeva Raya and Krishnadeva Raya, during these periods, they had a lot of strong army. But the successors of Krishnadeva Raya, including Achyuta Raya and then Rama Raya, they were not. And the other reason is Rama Raya, son-in-law of Krishnadeva Raya, had weakness for Muslims. He allowed many Muslims to occupy key positions in the army and administration of Vijayanagar, and they double crossed, it seems. And another thing is unity of Muslims during the time of Vijayanagar. Central India and South India was ruled by some of the Muslim kingdoms. They are called Bahmani, Golconda, Ahmednagar, Birar, Kalburgi, and such places. They all got united and then they fought. Before that, they were having infights, and that infight was great boon to these people. And unfortunately, they all got united, and that is one of the reasons. And another reason is, to any kingdom, to any empire and any nation, if happiness, prosperity, security, all these things are well established, within one or two generations, people become lazy and people will be lost in sensual pleasure. What discipline was seen during the time of Vidyaranya and later continued for few centuries, one and a half centuries, that was not seen later day. Bhogadiksham, as we see, that has been one of the reasons for the fall of Vijayanagar. And there is an interesting story. When Vidyaranya Swamiji started the Vijayanagar Empire, he wanted to have the foundation stone, Shankusthapana, and fixed a muhurtam. And he said, I will be in meditation and while I look into the right muhurtam, I will blow a conch. By that time, you have to place the first brick, install the first stone. But unfortunately, before he blowing the conch, another person, a temple devotee somewhere, he blew the conch. And these people mistook that, and the wrong muhurtam is also called as one of the reasons. We don't know how far it is true, but in Vidyaranya Kalajnana, it is mentioned. Then Vidyaranya Swamiji said, I thought it will at least remain for 2,200 years. Now it will come up to only 220 years. That's what the reality is.
Actually, Dr. Padma Subramaniam, she reminds me that 45 years ago when she went to Hampi, I believe the local people there said that in those Hampi nearby villages, they hated the Lambadis because Banjaras, because according to local stories, I believe they were the ones who showed the Muslim invaders the route to Hampi, which was otherwise not known, I believe. So they were the ones who cheated. So I believe to this day, they said, we don't like the Banjaras because they were the one who led the Muslim invaders into Hampi.
Gypsies,
yes. This she had heard from the local people in Hampi 45 years back.
Uh-huh.
There is one question from Purnima Venkatraman. She asks, because now that Hampi is in ruins, she is asking this question. Temples are basically about bhakti. So why can we not make new images like what happened in Pandharpur temple, install them again and have the Hampi temples also open for worship?
It's a very good idea. Certainly this idea can be mooted up.
There are two more questions which have come in. One is Madhura Vijayam being taught now as part of the Sanskrit syllabus in colleges and universities? And the other question is, are there translations of Madhura Vijayam in other languages other than the one mentioned in English by Dr. Gayatri?
In Kannada, it is being translated into both prose and verse. Two translations are available. Into Telugu, it is being translated. I don't think that it has been translated into Hindi. Perhaps Hindi people, there are many Sanskrit scholars, they would have attempted that. In universities and colleges, only few verses of Madhura Vijayam, mostly either description of Vijayanagar in the first chapter or the prologue of the poetess or the Madhuradi Devata who is coming in the dreams of Kampana and then describing the pathetic state of affairs on the banks of Tamrapurani and Kaveri, that portion. And that portion has been inspired by the 16th canto of Raghuvamsha of Kalidasa. If you look into 16th canto, where the Ayodhya is in shambles, that portion, and also Ganga Devi's this particular description of the state of affairs in Tamil Nadu, they have stark similarity. Very few verses have been given for the people to study in colleges and universities. That too rarely. It's not offered as a regular course in all the syllabus. Only whenever some syllabus changes go on, then they will be studied.
One person has asked where we can find that English translation mentioned by Dr. Gayatri, the details, the name of the author. I think they missed the name of the author.
It is Professor Professor Thiruvenkatachari. But I don't know if a copy is available now, if it is published again, because even I found it very difficult to find the translation.
The translation, does it contain the original also?
No, it is only the translation. It's not verse by verse. It has all the original text one side and then the translation. It's not like reverse translation. It's not in that way.
But it is a complete translation with the original.
Complete translation, yes.
How many pages it has?
Pardon?
How many pages? It runs to how many pages?
Remember, I need to check.
By any chance, if
it's
we can
a very view, small book, but it's a very small book.
The photograph of the cover page and the publication details.
I can give it to you. 1957 publication.
Many people are interested in reading Mathura Vijayam. Unfortunately, they are unable to read the original or even the Kannada translation. And this way, for the younger people, we need to provide English translation. Some of my friends here in Bangalore, they were attempting. I told, this is without thorough research, you should not attempt. Mere translation now, you will not get mature. You have to give a lot of explanatory notes and historical perspective and to be properly provided.
But it's published by somebody else.
It can be scanned and shared, I think. Scanning and sharing can be done, I think.
I can send you the copy of the translation. That I can.
Only the portion of translation can be scanned and shared.
Sure, definitely.
So that, many people will get to know about that.
It's very archaic. The language is very archaic. The English. But it's good. I mean, for a work which has no translation at all in English, this is very good.
Those were the questions which were asked. So if any other comments have to be added by Dr. Gayatri or Dr. Ganesh, they are welcome. Otherwise, I think we can wind up the session. So any comments? Any other aspects you would like to add?
This translation is from Annamalai University. Maybe we can try there if they still have Annamalai University publication. So we can try if they have some more copies left there. Or I'm very doubtful.
Before 60 years.
Yes.
I think I'll propose the vote of thanks. We didn't realize how time has gone so quickly because there was so much of information that was being given. At the outset, of course, I would like to offer my pranams to our Guru, Padma Bhushan, Dr. Padma Subramaniam, for not just the encouragement, but being there. And telling us that, boarding us, telling us, yes, you are on the right path. Thank you so much, Paduka. It is that blessing which is keeping us going constantly. And of course, it has been a great fortune to have Dr. Ganesh here. He is literally a walking encyclopedia. And from the way he was speaking, we know that there was so much more coming. And the session probably was a little short for him to even give a percentage of what he has known about the subject. Special thanks to our young researcher, whom we call as our Melody Queen, Dr. Gayatri Kannan. And as Dr. Ganesh said, her talk was as sweet as her music. And she brought alive Mathura Vijayam in front of us. And I think all the negativity or the negative aspects that Ganga Devi has written in it is not for us to feel dejected and depressed, but to give us that kind of energy to see that we are able to reinstall all these places of worship and take our faith forward. I think that is a positive that we can take from the text. I would also, of course, like to thank the support that has been given by the secretary of Shankarlal Sundarpai Shashwan Jain College, Sri Abhay Sri Shrimal Jain, and the Mahindra Finance, which has helped and supported Nityodaya Academy of Performing Arts, Mumbai. We are also happy to tell that our next session has already been planned, which will be on October 2nd, which is a Friday. at 6:30 instead of the 8 o'clock timing that we have. We are having it at 6:30 because it is Gandhi Jayanti and a holiday. And we have a young researcher called Subramaniam Chidambaram who will be speaking about Sandhya worship. And the expert will be Dr. Srinivasan, who is retired professor of Sanskrit from Vivekananda College. So thank you everybody, all the viewers who have listened in to our session today. And our thanks also due to Ms. Akshaya, who came straight from her music exam to sing our prayer song. And thank you everybody. And we hope to see you again, not just on October 2nd, but for every session that we bring to you. Thank you so
just
much.
Just one thing. A few years back, Paduka choreographed for this Madhura Vijayam.
Yes.
And we danced in Hampi, a shorter version. We danced in Hampi. And here in Chennai, Naradakan Sabha, we did a full length, I think half an hour or 45 minutes, we performed entire Madhura Vijayam. She culled out verses from that and we performed.
It's on YouTube also.
Yes, it's on YouTube. Just portions of it is on YouTube. From the birth of Kampana till the killing of the Sultan, the entire thing, she made it into a dance drama kind of production and we performed that. So it was
Paduka, because typically Paduka, where she brings the Shastra and the Prayoga together always.
And it's a very favorite subject of hers also. So. Thank you. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much to everybody. And we hope to meet you all again very soon. Shubha Ratri.
Shubha Ratri to everyone.